You both collaborated with some big names, obviously Arthur C. Clarke, Terry likes Neil Gaiman, whatever. How does it happen? How does the process work?
Well, how did it start, Terry?
In this case, on the earth, I had an idea. Actually, I had it before, just after I'd sent my first Discworld book to the publisher. And I wanted, in those days, I was, I think, more for science fiction. But the publisher bought it, and that was it. And I became a fantasy writer, but in my drawer, sometime later, many, many years later, there was lying, when I opened it, my notes about the long earth. And I thought, this is damn good. I mean, this has got real legs on it. I thought also, this is actually vast. I need to do this with someone that knows about quantum bollocks. And Steve, and I knew that Steve did. Because we you know, it's like science fiction conventions and stuff like that. You bump into one another occasionally and, you know, nod and smile and chat. And that was it. I said, here it is. What do you think? What can we do?
Yeah, you also had a kind of long tail, the whole thing, didn't it? Because, your first two novels were science fiction.
Yeah.
And you were messing around with this third idea in the Discworld to come up, so that's back. But now we've known each other for about over 20 years now.
Oh, a long time.
As you say, we bump into each other at conventions and things. And after about 10 years, we went to an annual dinner party.
That's right.
We tangled on the book fair.
The Quienzegs.
Oh, yes. Oh, yeah. And Terry would say to me, what news of the quantum? And so on. And I'd have to be Brian Cox laughing. I did it very well for me, so far. So then eventually, I think it's 3 years ago now, we started talking about this idea. And then we went, just playing with the idea, really. Mm. And on we went to the point where it was my taxi. Mm. And our hostess was getting a bit twitchy. But it all came from there. Our agents moved in a little bit, facilitated this and that.
Yes, they do.
Well, I think in terms of the idea itself, it came from you in the 1980s, and it's a basic idea. It's very simple. It's a multiverse, but a very humanized multiverse. Lots of parallel worlds, but it couldn't be simpler to get into. You just step into the next world, which is like our world, it's a big complex. And you go another step, a slightly different world, it's on and on and on. And that was the core of the idea, and which is where we took off from.
I think that both being science fiction readers almost from birth, well, probably not birth, my mother would have been rather uncomfortable with those things. But as soon as I found science fiction, that was what I read the most of. Not too much fantasy, certainly.
We drove away from that meal, we kind of knew at that point that you were the bloke. And it really was the quantum bollocks that did it. So,
can I just interject the B word? I've got my sister sitting there. So, my niece. So, my niece's boyfriend.
What should we go for instead?
Quantum extrapolation.
I wash my mouth.
Extrapolations is a nasty word.
So we drive away from this rather lovely dinner party. Yeah. I believe Anthony Horowitz was there as well, wasn't he?
So good.
This could have been an entirely different book if we had said, do you know what, Anthony Horowitz, wouldn't he make it with his quantum extrapolations? What a wonderful novel.
Foils on there.
What fun we could have. So we drive away, Terry digs the notes out, you get them, you read them through, okay? But let's go fast forward then to the first time that you come down to the Chalk Valley and you walk in the office, and there's not much screaming and shouting for at least a couple of days, if I remember rightly.
We did have, I don't know, 6 months or so of phone conversations, basically.
Yes.
Bashing ideas.
I'm thinking of doing this, and what about this, and can we do this?
Well, this has to be an easier way than when you work with Neil Gaiman on Good Omens. Would be, at what speed was your modem at the time? Trying to upload that.
A donkey went faster.
Yeah, but it was mostly phone calls, though. We did some low-tech and sketching.
Saying, you do this bit. Occasionally a battle for who did this bit because it's a good bit, and you do this good this bit. So, if, yeah.
And in the middle of it, is it June or July, you went to Disco Convention?
Birmingham, indeed, yes.
And I do remember we did a panel on the Earth's Materials in front of an audience like this. So, I've never done this before, where, it hasn't been written, we were discussing it for an hour or something. Mm-hmm. And it was like a huge workshop. There was one or two quantum scientists around the world.
The whole thing is actually overwhelming, because what we're saying is that beyond this Earth there's another Earth, and it's almost exactly like this one, but known with other people. And if we get into that next one easily. And next one, next. And that, the first time I was thinking about this, I think, means everyone's a millionaire. No, everyone owns a world. And what's that going to do for humanity? I wonder how we can bugger it up. Sorry about the email.
Yeah, well, that was the thing. You said that everybody has their own Sutter's Mill, and you suddenly think, well, that's gold, has no
value. You mentioned about that piece, you did it.
Well, yeah, it's think of the longer efforts. I think a really great SF idea is it's simple enough that you can describe it in a sentence, so you just can't. Mm. But then it's got implications for all of those. So politics and ecology and economics as well. So I think Sutter's Mill was the first gold mine in Western America, which started gold. So a guy goes along to Earth number 5 and digs up gold again. So gold becomes, it might be useful as an industrial method. It's got an intrinsic value in it. So, yeah, you're in a world which it's not quite for free. You've got to go out and dig the farm. But there's an infinite amount of good farmland to choose from. So when you haven't got to work to... When you haven't got to fight for a struggle, how does it change your... how would society change?
Bartering for skills and things like that.
Yeah.
Which and realising that the best thing around is probably the person next to you.
Yes. Yeah. Don't you agree there's a lot of that actually in the Chalk Valley, isn't there? Hasn't it? David Pick. In terms of bartering of skills, there's an awful lot of that. I'll come and chop your hedge down if you give me that pile of coal and things like that. Yeah, so I like that. So suddenly we get...